these skills just
as a pebbly hill.
Thank everyone for coming. We're going to start our work session on the capital improvement plan, and I'm going to just turn the mic over to City Manager Bojenko.
Thank you, Your Honor, and good evening. Tonight we will be presenting to the City Council the City's proposed six-year capital improvement plan for fiscal year 2017 through 2022. As you will see, the plan was changed this year to facilitate greater citizen input. The process of developing this plan started this past fall when a memorandum went out to all department heads, including schools and the Pease Development Authority, asking that they submit their capital needs for the next 6 years. In September, to better educate the public on the capital improvement plan and the process, the staff presented a capital improvement 101. The presentation was well attended and many questions were asked of the staff. Then in November, the planning board held a public input session on the CIP during one of their planning board meetings. Finally, in December, the planning board CIP subcommittee held a public session to review citizens' capital improvements requests. The three meetings for the citizens' CIP 101, the planning board public input session, and the planning board's CIP subcommittee public session to review cities' capital improvement requests were added to the CIP process this year to involve the citizenry at a more detailed level, and it was at the request of the neighborhood groups. You'll notice that the plan layout has changed. Each element sheet contains priority level, indication of which ward the project is in, and a list of evaluations used to evaluate each project. Six new appendices were added to the book itself. One, a list of citizens' requests. Two, state projects that have no local dollars but will be done within the city boundaries. Three, a list of all studies used in the development of the plan. Four, pavement management index used by the public works in evaluating road conditions. Five, conditional sidewalk assessments also used by public works to evaluate city sidewalks. And that was completed this year with using two UNH interns. Six, map of each of the city's five wards along with an index of each of the streets located in each ward. And when you go online to look at the CIP, you'll be able to connect right to those appendices. As you can see, there's been many improvements to both the process and the product to assist the public in understanding and to have a better input into our capital improvement plan. After the three new meetings for the public were complete, the planning board subcommittee, which consisted of the chairman, John Ritchie, Beth Moreau, and Colby Gamester, met with myself and various department heads to review their requests. In fiscal 17, department heads submitted requests in the amount of $2.3 million that would directly affect the FY17 general fund budget. Last year, the City Council approved funding of $1,765,000 for these improvements during the FY16 budget process. The Planning Board adopted a CIP on January 21st, 2016. As in prior years, the board has developed this capital improvement plan with the goal of targeting a stable amount of the city's property tax revenues to capital projects. In the last six fiscal years, the actual average appropriation for general fund capital outlay has been about $1.3 million each year. To avoid the constant dollar target for a capital improvement budget, which diminishes value over the years, the city uses a policy to tie in capital expenditures from the general fund to a percentage of the city's overall budget. Specifically, the city's goal is to allocate up to 2% of the prior year's general fund budget to capital projects. The fiscal 2016 general fund budget is $101 million. Therefore, the capital expenditure target for FY 2017 would be approximately $2 million. After reviewing departmental capital project requests totaling $2.3 million, the CIP subcommittee reduced these requests by $312,400 and is recommending an appropriation of $2 million, or roughly 2% of the fiscal 16 budget. This level of funding is recommended to ensure the city can meet its obligation to maintain its infrastructure and the quality of life for its residents. It should be noted that projects that are bonded require a separate vote of the City Council, two-thirds vote, six council members. In addition, those projects identified in the out years, fiscal 18, 19, 20, 21, and 22, are for planning purposes with actual funding not required in fiscal 17. The total capital improvement plan scheduled for fiscal 17 is $95,126,000, funded by a variety of sources, including general fund, bonding, enterprise funds, federal grants, parking revenue, and other sources. At this time, I'd ask that the various department staff members present their details of the CIP for the period of 2017 to 2022. For your information, the City Council will be conducting a hearing on this matter at the City Council meeting on Tuesday, February 16th at 7 p.m. Final adoption of the CIP is scheduled for the March 7th, 2016 City Council meeting. And in order for me to submit my fiscal 17 budget to the City Council, you must have a capital improvement plan adopted prior. What I intend to do on Monday night is not go through this whole presentation again. What I will do is I will refer people to our YouTube to view it, and also I'll be talking to Alan Brady about having it replayed on Channel 22 a number of times, and we will publicize that. On Tuesday night, what I will do is I will have a summary similar to what I just described to you this evening, and I will also have loaded up the full capital plan, and if people come forward and have questions about specific projects, we then can go to those and talk to them during the discussion that evening. So at this time, what I'd like to do, I believe I'm going to start with Chief Achilles.
Before we start, Eric, Councilor Spear had a question.
Yeah, two questions. One, are we encouraged to ask questions during the presentation or wait till it's all done?
I think that we try to go to 8:30. So, I mean, it's up to you. If would you guys prefer to just stop and ask questions while we're at that particular point?
What do you think?
I'd ask the presenters.
What's that?
Well, I like it when I'm right looking at it to ask the question.
Yeah, otherwise, we just have to backtrack.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's fine. That's fine.
I had one more of a point than a question. I know in your intro, and you've done this every year, you emphasize, and rightly so, emphasize the general funded, revenue funded projects. And you also mentioned that the bonded projects have to go another vote after that, which is true. For me, personally, what ends up happening is I wouldn't really pay attention much to the bonded stuff because I say we'll deal with that later. And what ended up happening, one year we had a fire truck issue. And so my personal goal will be to kind of pay more attention to even to the bonded stuff. So if I feel uncomfortable about a certain thing, right, that I'd say, you know, we should address it during the plan process,
right,
so not during the bond,
right,
process.
And again, I would refer you to the book, which has a financial component in it. This is a capital improvement plan. It's not a budget. I think it's important to know that. But we did last year reorganize a lot of our capital improvement planning because we exceeded the 10% goal that we try to keep. For new council members, what we try to do is our debt service. We try to keep our debt service payments under 10% of the budget, so that we have a benchmark to go with. And so you'll see in the financial portion of the plan, which we don't go into in detail tonight, but more during the budget process, you'll see that we have maintained that. And we're, in terms of the amount of debt service we have as a city, we have a certain a cap, which we don't even come close to achieving, which I don't think we'd want to come close to. But there are ratios that you have to keep in place. And I think we're in a good spot keeping it at 10% or below. It keeps us, the rating agencies like to see, they don't like to see a situation where communities fall below to a low level, because that means that they're not keeping up with their infrastructure improvements. And at some point, there's going to be a large spike in those areas. So what I'd like to do is start with the chief and go forward.
Well, good evening, Mayor and members of City Council. First project you see before you is ambulance replacement program. This in FY17 will be the second part of the amount we've already put aside in FY16 for the replacement of the 2009 ambulance. Any questions on that? Let's keep moving. The next one is, you'll see the fireboat. This is an out year, FY18. This project would fund the replacement of the fireboat with a more appropriate size vessel. And we're working throughout this year on what the status of the current fireboat will be. Next item, this came up last year, but this will be an FY17 as a bond lease. This is a bridge version after reassessment of our current rescue and the project we attempted last year. This will look more towards a commercial chassis rescue body and support vehicle that will replace a 1987 rescue truck. Next item is an out-year project, FY19. This is the replacement of engine 6. This is continues our CIP rolling stock replacement program, a large apparatus, and that will be in FY19. Another out year, FY21, again a bond lease, the replacement of our ladder truck that's stationed at station 2. It's a 2005, and at that point it will be due to be replaced. Next item is something you haven't seen before. It's an FY17 under general fund. This project will purchase durable medical equipment for the fire department. A lot of times we try to put this within the purchase of a vehicle, but especially cardiac monitors, stretchers. We're also looking, and we had put it out in a press release, as a compression delivery device that's automatic to do CPR. Those items would be purchased for the $61,000.
Good evening. Thank you for allowing me to present my two projects to you this evening. The first project is to replace the existing voting booths that we have for all five wards. These booths are approximately 25 years old that we have currently in use and are in need of replacement at this time. Oh, I'm sorry, I was supposed to speak to the...
No, why don't you start with it? We have the booths up, so
okay.
Go ahead.
So, I just spoke to you about the booths. They are Franklin booths, which will be replaced citywide for all five wards, and they will serve the current voters for the city of Portsmouth. The next project is records preservation, and my records preservation project is for existing records contained in the office vault. This is the first of a three-phase project. The preservation includes deassification, mending, and reinforcement of paper as necessary, resewing, rebinding, and archival grade polyester encapsulation as appropriate. Those are a lot of terms used in preservation of records. Are there any questions?
Councilor Sear.
So I had just one question, being new to the process. It's actually more to the vehicle. What do we end up selling the other vehicles, the boats, the other vehicles? Is that factored into this, or is that go back
what
to the general
fund? What happens typically is that we will do a trade-in or sell it separately, and those funds then go back into either fund balance as an unanticipated revenue, or if it's for a trade-in, it could get credited against your purchase price.
Thank you.
Mayor. Yes, Councilor Dwyer.
The records, I assume, does this also include digitization, or have you already done that with these records?
It does include some digitization for the records. We're using CoFile Preservation. They're out of Vermont. They're a very well-known company that does many of the New England area's record preservations.
And but it doesn't, you don't digitize every, I mean, what's the policy there? Do you digitize everything that we have going backwards and actually then, and I guess if you do that, why strive, I can understand why some records might be, but why strive to preserve in paper form, especially given the deassification and whatever, all the records? How do you think about that?
Well, you look at the older records that the bindings are really worn and they're so fragile they're falling apart. You really want to make sure that they're preserved in their integrity for future years going forward. It's three phases. They've broken down. They've done an evaluation of all of our books in the vault, and they've broken it down into three phases as to what projects they feel are necessary to go forward with first.
Kelly, I think the question really is do we really need to do that?
Right, if we're digitizing.
Or we just digitize them. And I think that, I'm not sure if state law requires us to keep them that form, or can we digitize them?
Yeah, no, you have to keep record form of them, and you okay. want to preserve them going forward in the coming years as well. But yes, they do need to be retained in their current state.
Okay.
Councilor Sear.
In regards to the digitization, you know, for what is actually done, is that then available to the public? Can we put that on the website or some other location? Is there a process for that that
that certainly
vendor
can be
does?
Looked at. Mm-hmm. It's something that I would discuss with the vendor itself to see what it is that they normally do in the process and how they normally make those records available going forward.
I know further on in we have discussions of content management systems and other IT infrastructure, and it would be good to have some of those conversations crossing back and forth, I think.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
The next project under buildings is for the Fire Station 3 replacement. This will be an FY17 as a bond lease. After feedback and an evaluation from previous councils of presentations was to replace the station from scratch. We've looked at opportunities to renovate it and try to get 5 to 10 more years out of the fire station. So we're looking at the mechanical and electrical upgrades, physical building deficiency upgrades, and some regulatory upgrades that we have not done in previous renovations.
The next two slides.
Hold on. Councilor Dwyer.
I'm going to have this point a lot, and so we don't need to discuss it each time, but I think it was a noble attempt to try to ascribe different things to wards, but I think it's a real mashup. And this is an example where, for example, we ascribe Prescott Park to Ward 5, but we don't ascribe Fire Station 3, which serves Wards 1 and 3, to Wards 1 and 3. You know, this is not an issue. I as you know, I believe we are one city. We're too small to be thinking like this and dividing things into wards, and I'm sorry for any of the staff time that went into this. However, if we're going to do it, I think we need to do it when it really makes sense. And so we don't need to, that's for another discussion, but especially if we're gonna make decisions about this, I think about half of these are misascribed.
Right, and again, I have concern about that too. We talked about that internally, and we wanted to go through the process this year and see how it all worked out. We debated about putting even the wards in. I had some concerns about how you would then make that determination that you're ascribing, as you said, Prescott Park or not to, you know, it really is an all ward type of situation. Right. So we came very close to not even including that in this year. And I felt we were trying to listen to some of the public input. We may not even include that next year because, as you can see, by and large, there we might even what I might do is put something in an appendix that might address some of that as well. And I think what people are really looking for in ward situations are sidewalks and roads,
and those are the ones that we didn't ascribe to wards. So to me, that's why it's such a mashup. So
some of those go beyond each ward as well. So
yeah, but
I mean,
I just don't believe in piloting bad data, because bad data is going to exist. People are going to make decisions about it. So I think we're going to have to make a council discussion of this, because there's no sense having 1 year's worth of bad data.
I agree with you. I agree. And again, it was to try to bring that into a public request.
Right.
And quite frankly, I don't see the purpose of it. For a value in that many of these, you know, road projects even go from one ward to the other.
Sure.
So I think it was a staff trying to do the best they could. And again, I think maybe the ward element of the element sheet could come out next year if that's what the council wants to do. I think you're right, because it is online and other people are looking at it. So. I think other than that, I think the changes made, I think, are very good. I think and we did debate internally about using the ward. It was a debate internally, but a good point. The police department?
I am David Mara, chief of police.
The next two slides go together. This slide, this project would fund the design and can, this project would fund the purchase of land for a new facility if a current city-owned site is not available for this purpose. The next slide has to do with the project for the facility itself. The results of a space needs study conducted in 2014 determined that the current facility no longer meets the needs of the police department. This project would fund the design and construction of a new facility after a site and conceptual design are complete. A copy, if anybody wants to review the space needs study, we do have it on our website.
Councilor Dwyer.
One thing that we voted for in the last council and we voted to fund was training for our council on the specific needs of a police station, because with the idea that either acquiring land, which could be opportunistic and occur at any time, or a police station is different than other sorts of buildings. I think we were convinced by that, and because the police had originally were going to provide that training, and then they got all balled up in their process and couldn't do that. We as a council elected to put aside the funds to have that training. So assuming that there might be land acquisition in the coming year, I'd like to get that back on the, since we already voted for the funding for it, I'd like to get that back on our agenda so that we have that background.
I believe what you're talking about, so I'm clear, is the firm that did this and did the space analysis is what you wanted the council.
No, okay. I do not want that firm, because we all agreed that was the worst, one of the worst plans that we had seen.
No, but well, I'm trying to understand what you want. So.
Okay. Well, in the minutes, long about, I don't know, May last year, we voted to, the police department had identified a training firm that trains people in the kinds of needs that police stations have as buildings. We had identified that in the, as a council, we voted on it, and I think the amount was approximately $2,500 to $3,000 that would simply provide us as the people who are going to be saying yay or nay to an amount of money with background on the special features that are required in a police station, so that we're not just carrying over our other building knowledge and saying, oh, why do you need space for that many cars? Why do you need XYZ?
Sure. All right. I'll check with the, I'll talk to the police and offline tomorrow and see what we can come up with. Okay.
If I Councilor Spear.
Sorry, Denton can just, he can, if he wants to go first.
Oh, no, I was.
No. Oh, so anyway, I was going to ask you think about the decision-making process, the coming together to with our other projects, the library, the middle school. They were a lot more involved. There was a lot more of from a process standpoint than simply having it on the element sheet and say, let's acquire land and build a facility. So I'm going to ask some questions. But I think some of my questions really should be answered in that type of process, not just spitballing it. So I think these questions have been asked already, so I'm going to repeat them, but I'll ask them every year until we figure it out. I know we had been asking questions about renovation with the existing facility, and I know we heard that it's not going to work, but we want to hear more details about that. We also know that there are challenges within on the municipal side of the house with this complex. There's certain structural issues that need to be addressed. And tying in with that, kind of all the same package, if we want to do land acquisition, does that going to include a new municipal complex? Because I'm just thinking I'd like to see them continue to be together. We had efficiencies when we brought the school department in. So rather than the element sheet saying police department land acquisition, it might say municipal complex land acquisition, which might be something I could look at, or renovation in place. You know, there's a lot more going on than just one thing.
And let me speak to that. We do have a retreat on March 12th, and one of the subject matters was going to be this building. And we were going to have so you'll have a full discussion on that then, because we'll be prepared to talk to you about the pros and cons of being in this building on a long-term basis. So yes, that's going to be on for March 12th. That's a big decision.
Chief?
I'm sorry to interject, but I was going to just point out that Manchester went through this same process. We did have the same architectural firm. We did have good luck with them, but we also had a municipal complex, and the police department was part of that. And I'm sure that if anybody would like to, I could arrange to talk to the people in our public works, as well as have that firm at the Manchester Police Department. I'd be glad to arrange having a tour of it, and you can talk to the Manchester officials about what the whole process they went through. Right. As well.
And thank you, Chief, and we'll talk about that, coordinating it. But I think on March 12th, I really need to get some policy direction from the council. So subsequent to that, we might take you up on that offer.
All right, good evening. Steve Bartlett, the business administrator for the school department. This first slide shows a placeholder on an out-year project in FY19. We have a tri-annual request for $500,000 to put towards maintenance and improvement projects on the seven buildings that we maintain. The second slide shows that at this point in time, we are planning on spending that money on upgrades to the high school auditorium, an energy project, and to do some work at the athletic complex. The next slide shows the allocations for the ongoing elementary school upgrade projects, 17, 18, and 19. In 16, we started the first half of Little Harbor. In 17, we will complete the second part of the Little Harbor project and begin to work on the Dondero project.
Good evening. This next project identifies funding for the Prescott Park facilities capital improvements. The trustees of trust funds who are responsible for the care and maintenance of Prescott Park have done a lot of work over the years to maintain the facility, and recently through the capital improvement plan, the City Council has seen fit to identify funding to assist with larger capital projects that are needed. As you're also aware, a new lens will be applied to this element sheet in the coming year with the completion of the Prescott Park master plan, which will be cause to revisit the strategy of this particular strategy, but still likely require the need for additional funds going forward. This next project is for the historic marker replacement project. This has been an initiative of the Community Development Department for approximately the past 8 years, replacing the approximately 45 1970s era etched metal plate markers that dotted the downtown and surrounding neighborhoods. This work is typically funded on an every other year basis, and no new funding is requested this year, though we are always looking to leverage neighborhood and involvement of other organizations interested in the marker types. This next project is for municipal land acquisition. Each year through this element sheet, a even number of funds, a consistent number of funds are set aside to accumulate in order to respond to opportunities to purchase a land that has been deemed should be municipally owned, either through the Conservation Commission or the Planning Board or some other opportunity. So these funds are typically used to be matched against other funds, grant funds, external funds that become available. This element sheet represents the ongoing commitment to implement the Pierce Island Master Plan of 1999. Through this process, consistent funding has been set aside over the years in order to accumulate and pick off pieces of that 1999 plan. And this year, the same is recommended in order to pursue planned improvements. Of course, this will be done in conjunction with the timeline associated with the wastewater treatment facility. This project, the Sagamore Creek implementation of the master plan, is a follow-on to the recent adoption by the previous City Council of the Sagamore Creek master plan. This project, similar to the Pierce Island master plan, envisions setting aside funding to make progress on the envisioned improvements from that plan. So this year identifies funding coupled with previous year's funding to make some of those initial improvements become reality. This next project is for the Chestnut Street streetscape improvements. This element sheet envisions a partnership with the Music Hall and the city for streetscape improvements that will address a number of not only aesthetic but also functional and safety improvements for this portion of the street, as well as be a unique wayfinding enhancement opportunity. So this is identified for funding in the current year, combination of revenues from the Urban Development Action Grant Fund as well as bonded funds.
Good evening, Juliet Walker with the Planning Department. This next project is the McIntyre Federal Office Building Planning Implementation Project. The funding is identified for the out year of fiscal year 18 to supplement previous year funding. City staff, as you know, city staff and the city council continue to work on this with relevant federal departments on the future of this downtown property.
Just to mention for the public and the city council, the industry day is scheduled for March 5th, where the GSA will gather at the McIntyre building to have those interested in posing on the building do the tour. In addition, we're looking to determine if we're going to keep the full industry day there. They're renovating their conference room, so we'll get more information out on that. But I just want people to know that this is moving forward, and the RFI is out and is available.
This project is for the reuse of the Paul A. Doble Army Reserve Center on Cottage Street. Funding has been set aside in previous years, and new funding in FY17 is recommended here in order to ensure the implementation of the Recreation Board Subcommittee's recommendation to move forward with a senior center / community center at this facility. This project is the park and playground improvement funds that are recommended each year as part of the capital improvement process. This spring we'll see the completion of the Haven School playground project, which is the last of the major renovations of the city's neighborhood playgrounds over the last 17 years. Larger funding portions have been set aside in previous years to ensure that those deep dive investments in those neighborhood parks could move forward. Now, with the completion of those projects, we as a staff are recommending that in order to maintain a consistent level of service in all those neighborhood parks, we set aside a smaller amount of funds to protect those investments and ensure that we don't get behind in future years.
Yes.
Have you had a sense, are there any, this completes the existing neighborhoods parks, right?
Correct.
Have you had a sense, are there any gaps that areas or neighborhoods that don't have a nearby playground that you feel needed one?
We've had a couple inquiries, but those would be more, and David, correct me, I think they're going to be more along the pocket park type than anything of any major significance. I think the Sagamore Creek is going to probably be the next major passive park. But in terms of neighborhood parks, do you think of any, David?
Every once in a while, proposals come forward to follow up on potential new opportunities, and we explore those. But we have not seen a large number of those or a great depth in any specific requests.
So I'm going to put one out there. I don't have a specific location, but I've seen playgrounds in downtown settings that can be wonderful. While at least one parent is watching the kids in the playground, other people are able to enjoy their dinner or go shopping and whatnot. And I've seen it happen, and Newburyport has one, and a lot of great. So I don't have a location downtown I'm thinking about, but I'm just throwing ideas out there as an option.
Councilor Dwyer.
I have two locations. Do you remember that there used to be playground equipment for young children beside the library? And that was one area that I think in the middle school renovation that we had hoped would be at some point put on this list, and that was very very heavily used for the reason that Eric is talking about. And then Granite Street, you know, the Granite Street field, there's the field that we own in front of that, and I don't believe that neighborhood has playground equipment. I think, especially since that also has the bridge over the highway, that could be well used by I think plenty of people. So those are both where we wouldn't have to create a park, but we could add some playground furniture.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor Lowndes?
To go back one, Dave, the Doble Center, what's the Daniel Street Trust?
That is the trust that was set up when the city council sold the Connie Bean Center. Oh. And the Attorney General's Division of Trusts required us to set up a trust for that. So the money will be used out of the Daniel Trust for recreation purposes. And we typically, before we would commit it, we would make sure that that we got the okay to do that.
So the next project is the Consolidated Indoor Recreation Facility. This is an outgrowth from the Recreation Needs Study of 2010. This is for future years, but it is a placeholder of sorts for moving forward with that multi-generational concept for a new recreation facility in the city. The core recommendation of that study being the moving forward with larger multi-purpose facilities for recreation. And another follow-up on that study is the outdoor recreation facilities. That study identified the need for approximately 3 to 5 rectangular regulation-sized recreation fields that are in high demand in the city. And this element sheet sets aside funding in order to make progress in adding to the inventory of those fields.
Councilor Spear?
Yeah, a question about the dollar amounts. They seem very low. Mm-hmm. If we include, the reason I'm recently motivated about this, we heard a lot of description about the need during the Sagamore Creek committee study, and I'm hoping that, I know you were talking earlier, the capital plan committee was struggling with trying to get that matrix to stay below the 10% bonding amount for operating above the operating costs. But anyway, I'm putting my 2 cents in here that I think this is an area where we might need to
reconsider. Let me just say that the money that we are talking, we're in conversation with some ideas and some properties. Really don't want to get into it too much, but we'll, if things materialize, and that's another thing we'll talk about at the retreat. The money that we have set aside, $2.6 million, might be the money that would be needed to purchase the land. I think the key item here is the first step is to purchase the land and secure the land. The ideal situation is to secure enough land so that you have the critical mass of fields in one area so that you're working on your economies of scale. So that's where we're headed. And we believe that the money that this would not be for building the fields.
Right.
You know, we do have a study done that we're working with the rec department on what it would cost to build. But again, there's possibility of partnerships that can develop out of this as well. So, as I said in the discussion at the beginning, when we look out at 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, we specifically don't try to nail down a number, but more for identification purposes. We don't lowball it by any means, but we also don't overstate it. So if we had a good opportunity that came to us for what I would consider a good critical mass of land that would provide the fields, I will come to the city council, and I think it would be our opportunity at that point to secure that land. And then going forward, reaching out to people, other organizations, to see if we can partner. But once we've secured the land, we're in a better shape to plan for it. But so I guess this is really to deal with securing the land.
Just securing the land. And so I guess for me, it portrays an incomplete picture, because I know we're going to need to spend money to actually build the fields. And I hope we're not going to wait until FY23 before we build the fields.
Again, that's going to be for the council to make those decisions, because you have to have, you know, quite frankly, you have to have the willpower to try to stick to the 10%, because rather rapidly you get yourself into a lot of trouble.
Right, and so it would require a reprioritization.
Sure.
Other things would
sure,
have to
absolutely.
Slide, and
yeah.
I get that. So what I'm saying is I'm putting in my two cents that I think this is a priority that I think we should
and
move
and we'll
on.
Be bringing something to the city council rather soon.
Okay.
Councilor Dwyer?
What's the source of other, what's the other there, the 600,000 in
that,
this?
That could possibly be some kind of, this. It's either using the, deer, the excuse me, the Daniel Street Trust.
Okay.
Could be something using maybe other, let's say for example, we purchase a large piece of land, and let's say that has X amount of acres that is usable for fields, but Y amount of acres as wetlands.
All right.
We might go and say, well, the land costs a couple million dollars, and 500,000 of that we will leave as passive wetlands. And so that 500,000, we may ask the Conservation Commission to take that out of the Conservation Fund.
Okay.
So those are some of the things that we'll talk about.
So the next project is the reuse of the stump dump for a multi-purpose recreation field to help meet that demand on the recreation fields. We have set aside funding in previous years for this project, and we are currently evaluating, looking at the big picture of the needs of the recreation fields in the community, what the next step will be.
Well, one thing about this particular project, it's fluid, so that if we get a partner, if we get somebody in, let's say an organization that wants to partner with us, we have some numbers that we can put to it. What I'd like to just have Peter Rice just describe briefly, this has been an interesting project that we've been able to do. If you remember that site, it was a site that 7 years ago you would never have anticipated to have it as fields, but through the Public Works Department and others working with the vendors that we've had, we've been able to create a nice piece of property at literally no cost to the city. But Peter, maybe talk a little bit about that.
Good evening, Peter Rice, Director of Public Works. John is 100% correct on that. We had a piece of property that was historically used as a what they call the stump dump, and there was a lot of material left there. And we saw an opportunity with some of these construction projects that we had ongoing. The contractors needed space to lay down their material and stage, and we needed the site prepped to build a field. So through consideration on letting them use the space, we were able to leverage their activities. At the end of their project, they had, for consideration, they did grading, they did install retaining walls, as well as some preliminary drainage piping, and prepared the site for really as a blank slate to build a field, whether it's a turf field or whether it's a natural grass field. At this point, it's graded to that point. And the value of that effort is $250,000 to $300,000 in consideration. So it was a really good effort to move this ball forward, and I think it served the city well. But now we have a space that, you know, we're ready to, at some point, to move forward on.
And one thing I'd like to say about the whole capital plan, because we have a new council with a lot of new people here, and policy decisions may shift either way on priorities, which is fine. The capital improvement plan is really yours to look at, to try to, you know, if there's something during the year, if there is something that you want me to bring up from a staff perspective that's in the plan, but you think needs to be moved forward, we'd be more than happy to do that, because we have this gives us the opportunity then to bring it to you, and then from a policy perspective you say this is what we want you to concentrate on, this is where you want to go, and we would put that plan together and come to you and then rearrange the next capital plan to reflect that. So don't think that just because you adopt the capital plan in this form it changes and morphs even during the year when we have opportunities that arise. For example, we had an opportunity to purchase, you know, with the Great Bog. We were able to get grants, we were able to do a lot of things. And that took, that was something that was not in the capital plan. But it was important at the time that we take advantage of that opportunity. And it's a great piece of open space in the city. So these are ideas, these are things that we want you as a council to bring back to us and say, if you want us to partner with somebody, we'll work with the Recreation Board and whatever organization in town to partner. And hypothetically, let's say they put in half, we put in half, we might be able to get this done in advance of what we have here. We've done that with the council on many occasions, that if a group comes forward and puts money in, the city council has been responsive and has provided additional money so that project moves ahead sooner than that's in the capital plan.
Councilor Lowne?
So there is a group that's meeting tonight about this very topic, and at the appropriate time, I am going to suggest that we move this up and enter into a public-private partnership, assuming they're willing to go with it. Because I think we're long overdue for additional playing fields. This is a good site. I personally think we should have artificial turf on the surface, but.
Right. And again, I think it's important that we do move it up. Protocol-wise, probably the next step would bring it to the Rec Board and then finally get it to the City Council level at some point. The other thing to remember about the fields is that it was a priority, but we also had other priorities within the system. We had, of course, the middle school, which was a huge priority, but as a result of the middle school, we were able to upgrade our fields. We were able to upgrade the field at the high school, which has tremendous use as an artificial turf, and it's doing very well. And we have the new softball field as well. So we haven't abandoned the idea of getting these fields and moving them ahead. It's just that we had other projects that, quite frankly, were prioritized higher at that time, not because we didn't want them. It's just that it's just a fact of life that we had to live within our means in terms of the bonding. Okay.
Okay, next.
This item is to address some evolving operational needs within our solid waste division, or solid waste group of the highway division. And the intent here is to revisit how we're collecting a lot of the waste throughout the city and provide totes at a discounted rate for both recycling and solid waste. As you know, during windy days, a lot of the material in the in the open buckets tends to blow around, and having a covered tote allows for easier operation for our laborers, sanitation guys, as well as keep the stuff contained.
And again, this has come to the forefront because of the accident that happened on Friday. We're doing a full risk management review of it, but the totes are going to be a lot better for us to have because we have already equipped our vehicles with the loaders for the totes. We've retrofitted, and then eventually, as we go forward, where appropriate, we would look at the side loaders with the totes. But the type of community Portsmouth is, we're not going to be able to use the side loaders everywhere because of the types of streets we have. So Peter, along with Jacob Levinson, and are looking at this very closely. This is a typical type of project we may come back to you and move up because we'd like to have totes for recycling. We need to have a larger tote for recycling because of the amount of recycling we're doing. As you saw in the presentation, we have a tremendous recycling going on. So we would like to do the totes, and we'd provide them to each homeowner and talk to Peter about the totes for solid waste as well. So we're looking at that, and it's something, again, we'll be bringing to the City Council sooner than later.
This item is to address the liner and the outdoor pool as well as the gutter system, and it's outlived its useful life and needs to be replaced.
And Peter, before you leave that, I just want to say, and again, we're working with the Recreation Committee. We've heard people say that we're going to be closing the pool. We're not going to be closing the pool for the wastewater treatment plant renovation expansion. We're just going to reconfigure how people get into the pool. And so, for example, they'll actually be on the opposite side of the pool. Where the entryway is now will be the opposite side towards Fort Tree Island. And we're looking at temporary bathhouses as well. So I know people were concerned about that, and I want to just assure people that we're going to keep the pool open. Okay.
This item addresses a number of the grandstands and bleachers throughout the city. If you notice, in some of the fields, we've started to replace these the bleachers, and this money's in the out year. We'll continue that effort. This item is to address sound barriers, which have been requested from a number of neighborhoods along the Route 95 corridor. These types of projects have to be done in conjunction with the DOT, and they have to be done as part of a larger highway project at this time. We're working with the DOT to see if we can get them to change their way they are willing to do these projects. There was, from the past commissioner, there was some interest and willingness to explore some options that could push these forward separate from their projects. However, with the new commissioner, we haven't had a chance to take up this topic with her yet, but we will be reaching out to her in the near term.
This next project is for additional funding for improvements to the historic cemeteries. The city of Portsmouth has six historic cemeteries and burying grounds that it maintains. Last year, we increased the amount of funding set aside for these improvements, and we completed the Union Cemetery front enclosure fence on Maplewood Avenue, as well as the reconfiguration of the receiving tomb at the Union Cemetery. And we have other upgrades identified in a 2013 assessment that we plan to carry out with these additional funds.
This item addresses retaining walls throughout the city, and the city has over 30 retaining walls, and this would be to maintain and upgrade retaining walls throughout the city. The city has over 61 miles of storm drains, piping, and structures throughout the city. They vary in age and quality of repair. These monies identify monies to do replacement and upgrades of the drainage systems throughout the city. This Public Works is responsible for maintenance of the municipal facilities. The monies identified here would go to upgrade the facilities throughout the city. We recently are in the towards the end of a completion of a programmatic study, which the manager referred to discussing at the retreat on the 12th. And so we'll be able to talk a little bit more about some of the items that were identified to be spent for this money. As part of a comprehensive look at our solid waste program, in order to provide flexibility with the changing commodities markets, having a transfer station with a larger area would provide us a lot more flexibility and would allow us to potentially change up our collection vehicles so that we could have smaller vehicles that with side-mounted that could get in some of the streets. And this would, the land identified here would allow us to expand our transfer facility to be able to incorporate those changes in the future.
Yeah, and this land is, if anybody's been out to the recycling center, this is land that is owned by the Foundation for Seacoast Health. And we're in conversation with them about acquiring this land. Obviously, it would need council approval, but we have been talking to them. This is something we've been looking at for a number of years. I think finally we're going to be able to get to the point where we can come up with a price that that both sides can agree on. And they have their requirements under the Attorney General for their disposal of land. So sometimes it takes a little bit longer. So we're working with them on this. So it really is, this is really something that I would say is an A priority for us because of the use of the facility.
Councilor Dwyer.
So is the money here all earmarked for design and building and land acquisition, or is there some construction money in there?
It would be for both land acquisition and design. And if we are able to do this prior to 19, I'd rather do it earlier. This is one of those types of projects that, from a risk management standpoint, I'd like to try to get it done sooner than later.
This item is to rebuild a building that formerly was beside the boiler building down in the lower parking lot. Would provide additional storage, dry environment controlled storage for records and other material. And this item is to address ongoing structural needs at the Hanover Garage. As you've probably seen, if you've frequented the garage recently, we've been doing some improvements, and this would be to continue those upgrades to extend the life and continue the useful life of that that structure.
Good evening. I'm Alan Brady, IT coordinator for the City of Portsmouth. As you can see from the first slide, IT requests have a total of $406,000, this being divided up into seven departments. A breakdown of each request is on the following pages. On page 81, requests for computers and laptops replacements. Following a four-year cycle replacement, there is a total of 94 computers that will be replaced, 52 desktops for the departments within the City Hall, 17 for the library, 5 for the fire department, and 25 computers and laptops for the police department, totaling $110,200. On page 82, server replacements. Six servers are scheduled to be replaced this coming year. Four in the citywide server room and two in the police department, totaling $48,000. On the following page, page 83, other technology replacements. There are three requests, a citywide virus spam filter, projection units, and a content management system, totaling $87,000. And on page 84, continuing with other technology requests, police and fire requests are upgrading their radios, projectors, and printers, and the school department is requesting an update of their VDI expansion, their projectors, printers, and network switches. Police requests are totaling $49,500, the fire is $46,000, and the school is $60,000. And on the final page is a breakdown per each department with a grand total of $406,000.
This slide refers to the Public Safety Records Management computer-aided dispatch system. The current system that we have in place has been there for 15 years and has become outdated, new technology. This hasn't kept pace with the new technology available.
Councilor Perkins?
Yeah, I was just wondering, in connection with the heroin and opioid crisis, is this software that, given the multi-jurisdictional nature of the upgrade, could, maybe we should consider moving up in terms of upgrading it in the timeline?
Well, this system, with other departments in the area, if they get the same system, which is a good possibility, we would be able to interface with them and share information on a lot easier basis.
Is that information that would be helpful in sort of, that work, or is it targeted more at other uses?
I think it's targeted more at other uses, sharing offender data and also and things like that. This would be useful for.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor Sear?
If I can go back just real quickly for the information technology, I had a question just pop up for Mr. Brady. For the content management system piece here in the budget, is that a specific one that's been identified, and is that including design implementation for full website, or is sort of a placeholder while quotes are going out, or what is that for?
It's the beginning of the process. We have about 8 city websites that we look after. We're currently running a static system. The idea is to bring it into a content management system. There are several content management systems that are out there, and we'll probably do an RFP to get more information to find out which one would be the best one to use. A lot of different municipalities are using different content management systems, and so I've reached out to a couple of companies locally. I've done a lot of research into a lot of cities, in the U.S., what they're using. So I think that what we'll do is go out for an RFP and see what we could see. But there's a ballpoint figure of estimated cost of what a content management system would cost for what the city requires.
So I guess the secondary portion of that is typically if you just pay a license for example a content management system, you still have to design and implement the website, which would be an additional piece. Or is this sort of lumping all that under
what I've noticed model? Now is the licensing for content management systems are free. You can use open source ones. A lot of them are using open source. There's Jambalaya that's out there. There's WordPress. You know, and there was some that, you know, there is a fee, but usually if the ones that is a fee, they usually drop down the price of the design because the design is a templated design, so they can roll out these templates, you know, throughout city. So the question becomes, what do we want? Do we want to have an individual design? Do we want to have a template to look like, you know, another city? So there's quite a few aspects that, you know, that we're looking at.
Sure. And again, I think that I'm excited that Josh is on the council, and I can maybe
I might have a few opinions about it.
Maybe have some ideas that we can pick your brain on. So we'll be in contact with you about that.
Great.
Okay.
Free public parking and shared lot arrangement.
Yes. These monies go towards some of the private public agreements we have with the various lots throughout the city and provide spaces in addition to the publicly owned lots.
And before you leave that, I'd like to just have Juliet speak a little bit to the shuttle, because we're in the process of putting together an update on our memorandum about the shuttle. And I just think maybe, Juliet, you can speak to that just briefly. So, I don't want to go off track here, but I think it's a good time to just at least give a brief update to the council on the shuttle that we were utilizing to CCC.
Yeah, so we started a free downtown parking shuttle between the Hanover Garage and the Connect Community Church parking lot, which we lease from that church. We call it the Market Street Church lot. A couple years ago, we've tried different running times, operating it through different months, and we have a sense of the ridership data over 2 years. We're going to be making a recommendation that next year's shuttle, this season, 2016, be a modified version of that, of what we've run in the past, and a reduced service during what we consider the peak months based on the ridership data that we've collected, pretty much July, August, September, on the weekends. And then also have ability to operate the shuttle during peak events, such as the Halloween parade or other events that we see a lot of demand for that aren't in that window. We also are exploring partnering with Coast. I think there was a recent article in the paper, so you might be aware about that. They are pursuing these kind of opportunities in communities as an alternative revenue source for them. And it's also gives us the ability to offer that service for a slightly less reduced cost. During this year, we'll also be evaluating other options and hopefully working with downtown businesses to determine needs, because I know there's also been discussion about trying to address employee needs, which are different than those peak times. So.
Parking lot pavement.
Yeah, this item is to continue the upgrades to the various surface parking lots the city owns, specifically many of the lots have pavement that is fatigued and needs to be repaved. This item is monies identified for replacement and upgrade of the various meters that we have throughout the city to come into to continue to improve our services. And we're looking at upgrades to the single head meters to improve their system so that they're credit card ready, as well as provide sensors and better data for utilization.
And just one thing I would say that we're, you know, just for new council members, where it says revenues, that comes out of the parking special revenue fund.
So this is the project. This project is for the Hampton Branch Rail Trail construction, also known regionally as the New Hampshire Seacoast Greenway. This provides ongoing, funding over a period of time to do design and construction of the portion of the rail trail corridor that goes through Portsmouth. We would be doing this in phases, but ultimately there would be a complete path from Barbary Lane down to the Rye Line. And we're with bated breath, the negotiations between New Hampshire DOT and Pan Am to actually finalize the acquisition. This would remain in state control in terms of ownership, but the agreements would be with each of the communities to enter into some sort of management and maintenance agreement with them. This next project is for the portion of Maplewood Ave that is within the downtown or near the downtown. There is another project currently going on that is farther out on the corridor. So this is from Congress Street to Vaughn Street. And this is looking to implement some of the ideas that were addressed preliminarily in a feasibility study, looking to enhance this corridor to provide a more comfortable streetscape for all users, pedestrians, bicyclists, as well as vehicle and transit. Oh, and I should add, we do have a contribution from the Portwalk project as part of a private partnership funding to help us get the ball rolling on this project.
This project is for bike, pedestrian, and transit improvements along Gosling Road in the northern portion of our city. Specifically, this project is moving forward with the design in a design assessment stage. It's intended to improve sidewalk pedestrian access for the residents who live along Gosling Road, connecting them to transit, and if possible, adding additional amenities such as those envisioned in the bike ped plan for this very street. This next project is the Chestnut Street Pedestrian Connector. The city of Portsmouth, the Chestnut Street used to run from the African Burying Ground across to the music hall portion, then onward from there. That property, this portion, which is between Porter and State Street, was discontinued in the 1970s. There are some pedestrian rights that we are trying to that we have, and with this improvement project, we intend to make this a more obvious and inviting and safe pedestrian way to connect the burying ground to the other portions of Chestnut Street, Vaughan Mall, and beyond.
This item is to provide an upgrade to the Market Square. As you know, Market Square was constructed back in 1977, and it really hasn't seen a major upgrade since that time. A number of streets around it have been upgraded, and it's at a point where we need to do some upgrades, some of the infrastructure underground as well as the above ground aesthetic streetscape items need to be upgraded. This item is to add sidewalk and intersection improvements along Spinney Road. It's going to be done in conjunction with the Islington Corridor project.
This project was identified in the bicycle and pedestrian plan, which was completed in 2014. It's to provide an off-road connection for bicycles and pedestrians along the North Mill Pond between Market Street and to between Bartlett Street to Maplewood Ave and then up to Market Street. So the fiscal year 17 funding is for the initial sort of concept design that we would be using both to talk to the rail corridor as well, the rail owner as well as property owners along this stretch. This project is the wayfinding system implementation. The funding is provided in an out year. We are currently implementing the initial phases of the wayfinding system. Many of you have already seen the initial signs that are out there for the parking lots and parking wayfinding. We are currently fabricating and plan to install the next phase, which will be vehicular oriented signs in and around the downtown. And then future phases will include more pedestrian oriented signing, particularly in the downtown, but other areas where it's appropriate for pedestrians. And then we also have a plan to do vehicular signage on the outskirts of the town, of the downtown, and other parts of the city.
Councilor Dwyer.
With the funding for FY 18 and 19, would that complete our wayfinding, Juliet?
That would complete the initial implementation, yes. Okay. And then we can, if there are additional needs identified at that time, we could certainly discuss that. We also have other parallel projects in addition to the signs that are going on. For example, we are looking at wayfinding for the parking garage internally, and some creative ideas for that that will be coming forward shortly with those. And I should also mention that we, as part of this current phase that we'll be starting to implement in the spring, we will also be hopefully working with ArtSpeak to look at designs for the back sides of some of those signs. That'll be a subsequent sort of piece of that project, but that'll be
and Julia, you might we will be working with the DOT on signage from the highway, so that's something that a lot of people have asked us to do, and so we're reaching out to them.
Yep. On that.
This item is the citywide sidewalk reconstruction program. The city owns over 70 miles of sidewalks of various materials. This summer we were able to complete a complete inventory an assessment of those sidewalks, and that report is included as an appendices in this capital improvements plan. The next page identifies the 2018-2019 monies and the streets that would be looking to do sidewalk improvements on. This item is a side path identified for Route 1. It was one of our highest priorities from the bicycle pedestrian master plan completed. However, the challenge for this project is that it has to be done in conjunction with the DOT. Having it identified and having it programmed helps us work with the DOT and show that it's a priority to the city, and we anticipate meeting with them. And we have met with them, and we will continue to meet with them to move forward this project. This project addresses the crosswalks along Route 1, and it's going to be done in conjunction with the last project we talked about. And again, you know, this is a safety issue. This is something that we want to move forward as quickly as possible. And if we see an opportunity, as the city manager said, we would come back and request moving it forward more quickly than the schedule, if possible. As I said, the bicycle pedestrian master plan identified a number of areas throughout the city to make improvements. This project would be the start of that in the Elwin Park area. The city has a number of at-grade railroad crossings throughout the city. The Department of Transportation has identified five of them to have upgrades. The last one that has not yet been funded and scheduled for project is the Market Street crossing, and these monies are identified to work with the DOT to complete that work. The city has a number of traffic signals that are antiquated and that need to be upgraded. The monies here are to continue the upgrade programs throughout the city, and in particular, the four streets, four intersections identified here are the priorities at this time. Along with the streetlights, we have intersections that require improvements as a result of requests from residents, as referrals to the Park and Traffic and Safety Committee, and these monies are identified to make those improvements as they arise. The Woodbury Market Street intersection improvement is a challenging intersection for folks who are disabled, and these monies are identifying a project that would be done in conjunction with a traffic signal coordination project that's currently underway, and this would help create a pedestrian refuge in the center to reduce the distance with which folks have to cross, and it would create potentially some green space in the area and make it a more functional, safer space for pedestrians to cross. The Andrew Jarvis intersection is to create, upgrade is to create some right turn lanes, which would improve the safety of this area and improve function. With the upgrade of, or the creation of the signalized traffic signal down on the bypass, the adjustment of this would improve safety by giving folks an option. Currently, people turn right to go up to Greenleaf Ave, which creates a dangerous crossing. And the reason they do that is because it takes so long to turn left. By creating a signalized intersection with a right turn lane, you can queue up for the left turn lane while continuing to shed the right turn movements, and thereby make a safer intersection and help reduce the flow of traffic trying to get onto Greenleaf Avenue by making that more functional. The Market Street Russell intersection has been identified as a project to be upgraded, and it's looked at from both a traffic signal potential as well as a roundabout potential. At this point, these monies are identified to complete that concept and move the project forward. The city has owns over 15 bridges. The bridge master plan would be to evaluate all the bridges and come up with a maintenance and replacement schedule for the bridges. The two bridges of concern at the moment are the Market Street Bridge, which we know requires some maintenance down near the Port Authority, the Port Authority, as well as the Pierce Island Bridge, which is our next slide. The Pierce Island Bridge has been identified to in need of complete replacement. We will be doing some maintenance work on this bridge this spring and summer to allow us to extend the life of the bridge for another 10 years. There's a grant program, an 80-20 program from the state where we would pay 20% as an aid program. However, the lead time for that grant is close to 10 years. So the maintenance work we'll be doing this spring will be to extend the life of the bridge to give us time to get into that grant program and to get those secure those 80-20 monies. The Maplewood Avenue culvert is identified as an out-year project. This is considered a bridge by the DOT. It is a culvert, but given the size, they consider a bridge and do consider it eligible for the 80-20 monies. It's currently not on their list, and we have requested to put it on the list, but we're waiting to get it on there, and it would be probably further out than the Pierce Island Bridge. The Kate Street Bridge is shown as an identifier. The final disposition of this bridge will depend upon the Kate Street extension that's being considered, and depending upon the outcome of that, the bridge will either be replaced or retired, potentially. The Long Meadow Road extension is to address a dangerous intersection at the end of Lang Road. What this would do is it would take Lang Road and connect it to Long Meadow Road, which is the intersection of Ocean Road, and it would help with the left turning movements onto Route 1. Currently, that action is a very dangerous action from Lang Road, and so this is to address that. The New Franklin Woodbury Corridor Improvements Project was brought to us by some residents and parents that send children to the New Franklin School, and we completed a design or a preliminary design of that improvements, and these monies would go towards the implementation, the finalizing of that design and the implementation of that project. The citywide tree replacement program is a continuing effort to continue to fund the improvements to our trees, streetscapes, and it's been a very successful program. The city has been a USA tree city for 16 years now, and we do a good job with that, and the Tree and Greenery Committee, working with public works staff, are able to utilize these monies to improve trees along the streets. Transportation plan studies and designs. These monies are identified for projects that come up through requests from the Park and Traffic and Safety Committee, as well as potential development types of activities, as well as requests from residents. So these monies are identified to accomplish those studies and designs. The Market Street Gateway Improvements is the continuing funding of the Gateway program, which should be going out to bid in the next month here for the first phase. This area goes from the exit 7 down to Russell Street. We're envisioning the first phase to be from exit 7 to the submarine way to the lights that are there. So we anticipate that being bid in the next month or so here. The street paving and management rehabilitation, similar to the sidewalk inventory, we have a pavement condition index done every year to inventory the quality of the pavement in the so that we can stay on top of the maintenance so that it doesn't degrade in any one area at a faster rate. What we do is we look at volume of traffic, the types of activities in that on each street, and we use a number of things. It's not just the condition of the pavement, but it's also use and the importance of that road that go into weigh the priority associated with the pavement condition index. And then the next page identifies the monies for 2018, 2019 for the roads that we'd be seeing upgrades to. And I should probably point out that both Deputy Director Brian Goetz and City Engineer Terry Damaris we'll talk about projects that they do, and we try to leverage monies as we do the streetscape projects. We try to also have utility work done so that we don't go back and redo work that we've done. So some of the projects they identify dovetail with the projects that are identified here. The Madonna Street area is a continuation of a phased program to complete streetscape improvements. In addition to the streetscape in that area, we're doing drainage and water and sewer improvements as well. The Islington Street improvements is currently in design. We're looking to complete this program hopefully in the next few years. This project will also have significant utility monies associated with them, so the $2.7 million identified here is in addition to other utilities monies. It's a significant investment in this roadway. The South Street improvements is shown as an out year, acknowledging the importance of that corridor for pedestrians and bicyclists and road and vehicles as being a major route. These monies would improve the street and the function. Pebble Hill Road improvements is to springboard off the work that we're going to be doing with the congestion mitigation air quality monies, which is was identified to do improvements to sidewalks. We're hoping this evening to hear that we have approval to start the process. It's been a long, arduous road to get this funding. It's been on again, off again, and it's been very frustrating, and I understand the residents in the area are very upset, and I truly appreciate their frustration on this. But we're hoping tonight to get positive news, and we will do a release, a news release or something to inform people if that is the case. The Pease International Trade Port roadway rehabilitation is identified here. We have about 17% of the roadways in the city in Pease. Through our intermunicipal agreement, we're responsible for the maintenance of them. The corporate drive corridor in particular is in significant need of upgrades, and the monies identified here would be to address those improvements necessary. And the next page identifies kind of the backlog of other streets in the Pease development, international development. The Banfield Road improvements is currently under design. The monies identified here are to complete the culverts that need to be replaced along the corridor. The project's also looking at a master plan for the complete area, and we'll identify additional improvements such as pedestrian or bicycle or other amenities, potentially some traffic calming. But the monies identified for FY17 are specifically for the culvert improvements in that area.
Councilor Dwyer.
I happen to be on Pease a lot today, and one of the things I wondered about were some of the intersections that seem to carry a lot of traffic but are four-way stops. Is that up to us to determine whether there would be, let's say, a light needed, an additional light at one place, or is that up to the PDA to make those determinations?
Go ahead, Peter.
Well, the agreement has the PDA responsible for if a traffic light were to be installed.
Okay.
But we work closely with them relative to stop signs and
one of the things they've looked at over the period of time is roundabouts, and they've chosen not to go in that direction. At some point, the warrants are going to be there for traffic signal, and we'll be working closely with them on that.
And would we then pay for the design? And
I'm not sure about that.
Okay.
Yeah. It's a point of discussion.
Yes. It could get real
so
expensive.
So a few more crashes first, right?
Well, let's hope not.
Well, you know, the one thing that we have to look at the municipal services agreement and see, you know, we are responsible for the maintenance of the roads. Yeah. Signalization may be something that they may be responsible for because it would be substantial.
The last item is an out-year item for the Junkins Avenue corridor. The area is in need of improvements. The sidewalks are starting to subside a little bit, and there's some it needs to be upgraded. So these monies are identified as an out-year for those improvements.
Councilor Denton.
Peter, while you're here, I apologize. I want to keep you on your feet and ask a question going back about 50 slides or so regarding the proposed solid waste and recycling totes, I believe they're called.
Yep.
Do we have the ability to weigh them currently before they're put?
It's funny you should ask. We have a intern that we've successfully applied, working with UNH, they received a grant to fund a student to spend time with us to do a classification of all our recycling, to see what portion of the recycling is waste, so what's a you know, a contamination rate, as well as our solid waste, to look at what portion of our solid waste is recyclable. So we're going to be doing spot determinations and weighing and going through to do a better classification. We do not have a mechanism to have a scale as we weigh, you know, as we lift. I'm not sure if they have those types of things. I mean, I could see it being a relatively easy thing, but I can imagine it being a maintenance headache, because you can imagine those levers, the tippers, take a lot of abuse, and to have something sensitive is a scale attached to it may be problematic. I think we can take representative samples and come up with a good number to give us an indication of what we see for contamination rates, as well as potential. You know, we're really excited about trying to see how we can take our waste program to the next level, and I think we're looking at split body vehicles. One of the big challenges for us is the downtown collection of the public areas, because there's so much contamination in those recycling that it ends up being really problematic from an operational standpoint. So we're looking at improved containers, as well as improved collection, education. We're going to be starting an education program soon, getting out and talking more. And we're also coming up with visual signs that better clarify what can be recycled and what should be in solid waste. So they can, instead of saying, oh, is this recyclable or not, they see a little picture, it shows exactly what goes in, and they do it, and improve the containers. We'll be coming to you this year requesting in our budget some additional monies for improved containers and things like that as well.
I have one follow-up, if I may.
Sure.
So a thought that I had, it doesn't necessarily belong here tonight, and if it's all right, if you could just mention it to Jacob and consider. I believe the ability to weigh these does exist. So the thought which I had is, instead of going for a pay-to-throw program, which I am in favor of, instead have a voluntary program where if people opt to use them with barcodes, have the weight, they could pay per pound, and then possibly the city work with Mr. Fox or whoever else, and then they would get free compost disposal. So
we can take a look at that. We'll you know, include that into the mix and see what ultimately it will be. That's going to be a major policy decision.
Yes.
Which we can have a lot of conversation on.
Yeah, I saw that in another city the other day.
Okay, enterprise funds.
Hey, good evening. Brian Getz, Deputy Director of Public Works. I'll be covering the water projects. Terry Damaris, City Engineer, will cover the sewer projects. The first item is the annual waterline replacement program. This is an ongoing program that is done programmatically every year to replace and upgrade water lines. And as Director Rice said, we try to do these projects in conjunction with roadway projects and sewer projects, because you know, if we dig up a road, we don't want to do it two or three times. The next item is our well station improvements. We do have 9 wells that serve the water system in addition to the surface water plant, and these monies go towards annual upgrades to improve the equipment and the operations of those wells. Likewise, the next item is ongoing work to improve pressure and storage improvements. These improvements are identified through our water system master planning project, and they are programmed out for the years to do those pressure and storage improvements. The final item on the water side is reservoir management. This project will upgrade the water flow controls at the Bellamy Reservoir. Okay. That is our surface water supply.
Excuse me, Councilor Perkins, it appears that you're chairing the meeting now. So I think Councilor Dwyer had a question.
Oh.
Councilor Dwyer.
Given the publicity about the Newcastle fire, and I know we had already plans related to replacing water systems, does page 132 include some dollars associated with Newcastle upgrades?
The Newcastle upgrades are actually in the program already.
Okay.
They're sort of in reserve because it was a project that was identified in a previous capital program that is still there, but we're awaiting word on what they're going to do with the bridge, whether it's going to be a lift bridge or a fixed bridge. So once that's identified, we'll be able to engage an engineer that can then identify further.
But we already have the money set aside for that.
Well, yes. Well, the CIP, yes, it's been identified.
Councilor Denton.
So I have a follow-up question to a question which I asked the city manager earlier, so I'll repeat that question. In last year's capital improvement plan, so for FY16, there was funding listed for water efficiency measures such as water-efficient toilets, water-efficient washing machines, and it's what was included for FY17 was $50,000 from revenues, which is not listed in this year's, and the city manager assured me that we do have money for that. So my question is, would it make sense, and I simply don't know, to possibly list it as an off year for FY18, so just to make sure that it's brought up again in a following year? Does that make sense?
Right now, just so the council knows, we have about $220,000 left in that program that will carry over for that program. Brian, you want to explain a little bit about what about how much we've saved?
Thank you. So we've started to do some analysis because this program was introduced just about a year ago, and of course, as all programs, you know, you get the word out and the startup. So we're actually some of the early people that got both the toilet rebates and the washing machine rebates. We did some analysis of the before and after, and those that have done the toilet rebates are seeing a 30% reduction in their usage. So the efficiency's proven out there, and people that have done the washing machine rebates are seeing about 20%. So it's quite successful. We're gonna, with the data, we're able to get the message out. We continue to each month, we get 15, 20 rebates in. But as the manager said, we've got a lot in reserve, so we'll track that. And, you know, if we get to where we're at the end of the line of having those funds, we'll revisit needing to put more monies in there.
And I think, Councilor, what I think is probably important that we should probably put out some publicity on that, because I think we'll talk to Brian. We'll talk about this tomorrow, but I think it's important because those are impressive numbers, mm-hmm. and so we should get those out. Yeah.
Thank you.
Good evening, Terry Damaris, City Engineer. First project here under the sewer items is a Pierce Island wastewater treatment facility upgrades. This project is for the construction of the upgrade to the Pierce Island treatment plant to bring us into compliance with secondary treatment standards required by the Environmental Protection Agency. These costs would cover the portion of construction administration and oversight. And as you heard at our presentation on the 1st of February, we're anticipating bringing forward the first reading of a bond resolution for this project on the 16th of February. Next item is the Pease Wastewater Treatment Facility. The Pease Treatment Facility was built back in the 50s. Portions of this are in poor condition, are in need of upgrades. We're currently working on a project to upgrade the headworks, which is the beginning part of the plant. And the costs identified here are to do additional upgrades to meet anticipated future wastewater effluent limit permits. Next item is our city's long-term control plan. So because we have portions of our collection system, our wastewater collection system, that is combined with the stormwater system, we're required to have a long-term control plan to minimize and reduce combined sewer overflows. And this is the monies identified here help in the study design and construction associated with those projects.
Councilor Spear.
Is the six PY, that's six prior years funding?
Mm-hmm.
I thought we spent like $40 million on this thing overall, but.
We have.
It says zero, so I'll just pointing that out.
The this is a new sheet in the CIP. So you're correct that as for our sewer separation projects that have been completed, we have spent well over $55 million in long term, but they aren't identified as part of this specific element sheet.
Thank you.
The next item is the annual sewer line replacement. Similar as Brian and Peter have talked about for water and stormwater, we have around 100 miles of sewer piping. Some of that's 50 to 100 years old and in need of replacement. So these monies are for programmatic replacement of sewer as part of multiple projects in the city. And the revenues are for immediate term projects, and the bond values that are shown are for some of the larger reconstruction type projects like Islington Street, some of the larger programs. Next item is the pumping station upgrades. The city owns and operates 20 wastewater pumping stations. The lifespan of those pumping stations and the equipment within them is typically on the order of 20 years. So we look at replacement of those, and if you were to average it out, be one a year. A number of those projects have been done separately for our larger pump stations. This item here is for the smaller pump stations and is a programmatic funding. Next item is a Mechanic Street pump station upgrade. This is an out-year project identified to be completed once the wastewater treatment facility project is complete. And the Mechanic Street pump station is our largest wastewater pump station, and this would be a comprehensive upgrade to that facility. We're currently looking at beginning a site master plan, which will look at the site from the existing station all the way over to Pierce Island Road. Next item is a Goose Bay Drive sewer replacement. This is at the Pease International Trade Port and addresses replacement of an existing sewer on Goose Bay Drive from Corporate Drive that is in poor condition and at risk of failure. So in order to mitigate that, we're looking at replacing that this coming fiscal year. The last item is the Union Street sewer reconstruction. This addresses Union Street from Middle Street to State Street. The road is in poor condition and is in need of full reconstruction as well as all of the utilities. This is for the sewer component of that work, and we will leverage and work with the highway and water divisions to support additional funding for this project.
Yeah. At this point, we have completed the capital improvement review with you. As I've indicated, on Tuesday night, there will be a public hearing that the council will be conducting. We will have an abbreviated version of this. We will try to get people to watch it in advance. And if they have questions, we'll certainly have the slides available to people, and we'll have a couple copies of the plan available here in the council chambers, and we'll also have summary sheets available for people on Tuesday night. So we thank you for your questions, and certainly we will be talking about a couple of these major items during our retreat on March 12th. And if anybody has an item that they want me to look at with the mayor to put on the agenda, please let me know. And what I intend to do over the next few days is to get out a draft agenda to the council so they can take a look at it and see if there's something you want to add on to it. And we have some items, major items, but I'd like you to, if there are items that we haven't addressed that you want to address, if we can't get to them on the 12th, then it'd be good for me to have those so that I can try to schedule them with the mayor at a future date. Thank you.
Yeah, whatever we can't get on the retreat agenda, as to the prioritizing, we could certainly do with smaller work sessions in the future going forward.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Adjourned.
Thanks, Mayor.